Okay, hello, good morning. We will start the track after preparing the presentations in the computer. The first part related to the presentations of your work will be in English, but the discussion will be in Spanish if all people in the room can understand. And this afternoon, we will have a dynamic in order to continue the work and promote the networking between the different doctoral students. So, before the coffee break, we will have a block of presentation, and after the presentation, we will have the discussion, focus on these presentations. And after the coffee break, we will have another block of conversation of presentations, and also discussion. And the presentations are organized by level as you are in the first or second year of the doctoral studies, so you are in the first part, or if you are in the second part or you have a lot of experience in research, you are in the second part of the coffee break, more or less, okay? So you have 8 minutes per presentation, maximum. I will show you a 3 minutes card and a 1 minute card. And I will carry out this doctoral consortium with Marisol Ramirez Montoya from the Tecnológico de Monterrey, that is also part of the cluster of the teachers of the doctoral studies. And also, of course, Francisco José García Peñalo, that is the coordinator. So maybe you can say something.
I'm the coordinator of the PhD program in education and research at the University of Salamanca. Also, we have different PhD students in other different PhD studies, computer science, academic, and so on. Then, this platform consortium was born so related to this PhD program, but we are open to other this program because the idea is. That you present in so in a few minutes the essence of your research, but the most important is the discussion. Discussion about what's happened during the PhD. I'm a beginner in this, and I need the experience of the more experienced PhD students. Or I'm at the end of my PhD, and I want to know what's the tips for presenting or what's happened after the PhD, and for this we have the PhD of the programs from the different programs. Juanma is also with us. This afternoon we have with us Rafa Molina from the University of Alicante, another PhD. Then the importance to exchange. In the first part, in the presentation, we should use English as language, because the idea is that for many of you, this is perhaps your first presentation. And don't be afraid. Speak in English as you can, but try to express in English. For the discussion, we change to Spanish. Because we think that is more important for interchange the English. If you are not Spanish, you are Portuguese, you are from Morocco, use the language you prefer. You understand Spanish. But when you want to, or you have to work, to speak in your language, or try to speak in a mix between Portuguese, Spanish, English,
Portuñol,
or English. The idea is to exchange your experience and express your doubts, your faith, and with that, we try to help this idea. Then the presentation, short presentation, focus on the main ideas. 8 minutes, 5 minutes is enough. It's not too much interesting knowing all your souls or not the idea.
Yes, because if someone wants to know more about your research, you have time to speak during the room, during the session. And also people can access to the proceedings. So that's the main idea.
Yes, and this is a special moment in the conference, and we hope that you enjoy your presentation and enjoy the other presentation too.
Okay, so we can start. And the first presentation is spreading perception of fake news promoting hate speech against migrants and refugees in social media by David Blanco.
The thesis that we are developing is called more or less a preliminary thesis, spread and perception of fake news promoting hate speech against migrants and refugees in social media. So, why this topic? Okay, we have three aspects: social media, hate speech, and fake news. Why social media? Well, because they allow the spread and a very fast and a very broad spread of these two problematics, which would be hate speech, in this case against migrants and refugees, that's our topic, but it could be against any other vulnerable group. And then, of course, also fake news, which is probably one of the most complex problems in our current societies, democratic societies. And the problem behind this is that social media allow every publication or almost every publication to reach a broad number of people. There's some limit behind it, and there's also a generalization that is used. Any of us have at least one profile for sure, and in the end, almost everybody has it. And that's not bad per se, but it allows the spread of these contents, the hateful content, fake contents, because there is not such a control as with mass media in the past. In this context also of post-truth, which is a context in which facts are less important than opinions for the construction of the public discourse, this is a problem. And then another element in our contemporary societies is that migration is growing, which at the same time is having associated a stronger nationalism that shows or expresses itself with racism and rejection of immigrants that is being seen also on social media. And then finally, we have observed, there are studies that proves it, that fake news has been used to promote hate speech against immigrants, and that's actually our object of the study. And some previous works have said, or have already studied the attitudes against migrants. It's actually quite a common topic in the field of communication studies where we are. And those are the studies that we are going to use as a basis. And more specifically, actually, it's going to be the studies that focus on hate speech against immigrants on social media, usually with computational methods. And two examples there, the Stop Hate Project and the Farm Projects, they are both at the University of Salamanca. We are working on them. First one is supported by the CUE, and Farm was granted actually 2 weeks ago or last week by the European Commission. So we are working on that, and they are going to support also the development of these cases. Besides that, there's also fake news as an object of study. It's, most scholars say that it's an old problem in any context. The most relevant aspect of this new context is it's very, very fast and broad spread in social media. And then there is also the problematic around its definition. It's not the same fake news as false news. They are part of disinformation campaigns, but not all fake news are part of disinformation campaigns. There is also this context of false truth. So the problematization of this definition is already a very important element here. So with that, what we want to fill in is the knowledge gap of how hate speech against immigrants together with fake news interact and spread in social media, as I would say. We use three very important communication theories. We have the agenda setting, very relevant, especially in connection with fake news. We also have framing theory, especially in the depiction of immigrants. And then the most important of the three of them is the cultivation theory, because hate speech and fake news are used to seek fear-mongering against the other. In this case, the other is the group of foreigners in a country. And this fear-mongering is actually because they fear against it. It's what lies behind each rejection. Our hypothesis and research questions, of course, are very preliminary, but probably they show up in our specific objectives. No? So we want to see what are the perceptions of citizens about the causes, importance, and effects of fake news on one side, hate speech on the other side, and the interaction of them all on the third part. Then we also have the hypothesis, because based on the previous study, that false contents promoting hate speech about migrants and refugees are going to spread faster, farther, and broader in social media than truthful contents about these individuals. We also want to see, or to answer these three other questions, the three of them would be answered with an experimental survey. What characteristics are shared by individuals who usually believe fake contents? So, what defines the people that believes it? And then the third question would be, what defines the contents that are believed? So we have all the people and then the feature of the content. And finally, we'll try to observe how often can social media users differentiate true and false contents. So with the two previous questions and how they interact, we will try to experiment what kind of contents and what kind of people differentiate easily differentiate. Well, the methods very fast. We're going to conduct a survey. We are already working on that to see the perception of citizens about the problem. Also, trying to see the differences in terms of age, gender, socioeconomic status, etc. About the problem, the different perspectives. And then the most important or the central aspect of the study is the social network analysis. We want to use graph analysis and cluster visualization to see where is the problem, who is spreading fake news, how far, and with analysis of the scales, that's something quite innovative. We want to observe what's the depth, the size, and the breadth of fake news promoting hate speech against migrants and refugees. So, how far they reach, how many, if we analyze Twitter, for example, how many retweets each content would have, etc. And then finally, as I was saying, an experimental survey. We want to compare the reception of fake news and hate speech based on social demographic conditions, and the featuring of the content. So, we have the first survey to observe the perceptions of citizens, then social networks analysis to see the spread of the content, and then experiment to see the reception process. Well, expected results, more or less, have been anticipating them, and not too much time. So, some final aspects of the results of the survey are expected probably November, December this year. The results of the SNA process would be during 2020, and then the experiment will be conducted in the first month of 2021. And well, I want to highlight that this research is conducted in the support of an EPO grant of the Ministry of Science, Innovation, and Universities of Spain. And then, of course, it's in the frame of the Education and the Knowledge Society based in the University of Salamanca. And that's all. Thanks for your attention, and of course, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Padre Massimiliano Fia Padre.
We are going to use the Twitter API that it's download this sample. Then we are download a year period of sample. We want to use keywords like immigrant, migrants, but there are some events that can create a new hashtag. Like, for example, in Mexico was the migrant caravan the last year, and well, last year in Spain was the Aquarius. Well, that kind of events can change the keywords. Well, before we are going to use topic modeling and automatic sentiment analysis. Well, we at the moment doesn't have a result because it's the first year, but we expect that in December I want to start to download these messages. To do a pilot test, and then we start to the final sample, the complete final sample, to start the analysis.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mignano. And we will continue with the narrative close to quick smoking, indirect effects of audience character, similarity, and narrative voice in detection to quick smoking by Laura Rodriguez Contreras. Persuasion, and with this information
small receptor condition compared to the control condition, will produce a greater identification with the protagonist and a greater rapid export. The optimal receptor condition in combination with the control mission will produce a positive indirect effect in inhalation with the smoking through a model with primary mediators and secondary mediators. And the use of mobile application compared to the control condition will increase the intention to quit the smoking, improve the confidence in the ability to quit the smoking, and the perception of the effectiveness of the preventive response. So, three clinical studies are proposed. In the first study, the analysis was first person versus third person, and we favor similarity in high level. Will be manipulating. In this experiment, similarity will be manipulating depending on the degree of the vehicle dependence. And in the second study, a similar design will be used, but the behavioral similarity will be manipulated based on the number of previous attempts to stop the smoking. In these two studies, we created a story about a smoker that tells how he or she quit the smoking and the experience and the benefit of quit the smoking. And then, finally, basing on the result of the two previous studies, in the third study, a mobile application will be designed and evaluated. I show you a little part of the result of the first experiment. We access a sample of 6,680 Spanish smokers. And we carry out an OPAS and two contrasts to see if the optimal condition will increase the identification. In this case, the ANOVA was tendential, but the contrast was significant. The contrast one compared the optimal condition with the control condition, and the contrast two compared the optimal condition with the rest of the condition. So this contrast was significant, so optimal receptor condition will increase in identification. In the case of the narrative transport, no significant difference were observed, so no, the optimal receptor condition not increase narrative transport. And the hypothesis two, to respond to these hypotheses, we carry out analysis with protest. We use the model 81, and in this case, the optimal receptor condition is the independent variable. The identification is the primary mediator, and the post-Darwin lactams from cognitive elaboration, system efficacy, and preventive response are the secondary mediators, and intensive smoking are the dependent variable. In this case, we observe only four indirect effects. So the optimal reception condition is in the identification, and the identification increase only the increase other control, but only cognitive elaboration, certificacy, and preventive response increase the intention to quit smoking. So intention to quit smoking increase because optimal condition increases the certification, and certification increases cognitive certificacy and preventive response. In the case of narrative transport, no indirect effects were observed. So because optimal receptor condition didn't increase the narrative transportation. So in this case, no observed linear effects. And conclusion, and this time the field work of experiment 2 has already been completed, and at the same time the design of experiment 3 is being prepared. We will consider of a mobile application to smoking, to quit the smoking, and will definitely approve the result of the two previous experiments. Thank you.
of action, and so Ferrari Labs.
Acidification, oxygen reductions, and exploration and loss in the coral reef. In the cryosphere, loss of ice in the Antarctic, impacting the habitats of the marine species, and melting of Greenland. In the atmosphere, the world water cycle has been altered, producing increase in the density and frequency in the windstorm and fires. For the reason, the field vegetation is being recognized for the difference by the different international frameworks. For example, in 1992 was created the United Nations Framework Climate Change, which in Article 6 is dedicated to training awareness to access information on climate change. Following with this framework, in 2015 was created the Paris Agreement, which in Article 11 and 12 confirmed and explained the importance of education. And UNESCO also recognized education as a powerful tool. Education for climate change can be compared with a trip, where the route represents the components of the competence. This is knowledge, skills, and attitudes. Also know, learning to do, and learning to be. The trip top represents the actions against climate change through the education and mitigation. However, education on climate change presents obstacles. For example, the multidisciplinary action for the problem can be a challenge for many teachers. The scheduled time to teach climate change is marginal. For this reason, we propose the use of the new training tools, the MOOC. These tools has a potential to support lifelong learning, guarantees the knowledge creation, and create the develop the climate competence. The hypothesis of this project is use of digital resources, MOOC and online training, MOOCs and online training courses to achieve the climate competence for primary and secondary school teachers will improve overall performance and skills, knowledge, and attitudes on climate change education. The general objectives of this project is to describe the importance of education in tackling climate change through the creation of climate competence. The specific objective is to evaluate the efficiency of the new online training tools as MOOC awareness and training on climate change for primary and secondary school teachers. The next specific objective is to demonstrate that we acquire a climate competence for a MOOC. The methods that we use is a pre-experimental design with pre-test and post-test measurements. Until now, there have been two editions of this MOOC, but in this last version, we have 1,750 participants. 530 of them started, and 258 of them finished. The participants
four countries, but mostly from Latin America and Spain, to a lesser extent, Italy, France, Portugal, Morocco, and Mozambique. As a first observation, the Reluz survey, the participants were 29% male and 51% female. The majority of participants were people young, which aged between 14 and 35. The majority of participants had finished the university education with 70%. In the test that we used, we structured two parts. The first part contained information, a general question about the age, the gender, high-level educations, professions, and the countries where they were born. The second part, the agent was divided in two dimensions, the represents the components of the competence. These are learning to do, where the agents was divided in four categories. This is definitions, causes, consequences, and mitigation of climate change. The next, learning to do, the 14 items was divided in two categories, ecological behaviors and consumption habits. And finally, learning to be, the items was divided in inclusion of contents in education, responsibility actions, organizational responsibility, and the feelings and sensations arise when the people hear the word climate change. In conclusion, education presents a great power can we use through the new only training tools as MOOC in order to create and develop a climate change. Climate competence will help mitigation and adaptation against the climate change and save the planet. Thank you.
Abstraction using the SPC method.
sentence for situation, population, and question. So he prepared the string search, and then we executed it. So here we have the official definition started by Jamie Twing in 2006. Well, we have the keywords, so that is computer learning thinking, involves solving problems, designing systems, understanding human behaviors, and then that it includes a range of mental tools. Well, we have to say that Seymour Papert introduced it in his book in 1980, first in his book. So, and then we run across multiple definitions, but they are for most are okay to say that our CT is a mental tool, as a process, a mental process. Well, we explored in the literature the importance of abstractions for CT and mathematics, then how it is learned and reached, the appropriate age to learn it, and then the forms to explore CT, which is within the context of computer science curricula, and then the third way. And nowadays they are using a third form, which is mixing the two. So let's see the hypothesis. Well, initially we had to teaching to see if teaching CT had a relationship with abstraction and mathematics, and then if the teaching of abstraction could be done in primary education. Well, I say initially because when we wrote the paper, well, we had those two ones, and then when we read more and more, we changed the second one and added a third one, which is here we are focusing more on pedagogical methods or material to enhance and improve CT skills. And the third one is to see if teaching CT has a positive effect on the opinion that girls have on their technological skills. And the objectives we are going to see are the application, an overview to do an overview of the applications of CT in mathematics, then to explore the theory of APOS and mathematical, to develop mathematical abilities, and then to develop methodology to enhance mathematical abilities. Well, the second one have changed, and it is more focused on the tools and toys that we can use to develop CT skills. For our research, we needed a methodology that could help us at the same time explore the theoretical investigation and the development of solutions. And this is to solve problems using IT. This is why we went with design-based research. About the current and expected contributions, our question was, what could we do as we are working on the field of software engineering to help better the learning, the child learning? So, in other words, the objective is to help learners develop their learning abilities using computational thinking. And we discovered that in the literature that there is a lack of assessments in the field of computational thinking. And we all know that assessment is a key, is crucial to measure the value or the effects of the learning. So, what we want to do is following those steps. Create activities to enhance computational thinking. Choose artifacts that would help us to do this. Otherwise, build them if we don't encounter any. And then collect data those data will be collected from the interaction between those tools, those artifacts, and the children. Then develop an application that will collect those data and help us analysis to analyze those data, and finally go enter a loop of improvements. Here we have a visual of what we want to do. Well, the first part, this one, covers what we encounter in the literature. And then the second one is what we intend to do. Last but not least, I would like to express my gratitude to Derecho University of Cádiz and the UNESCO L'Oréal Foundation for Women in Science for their support. That's it. Thank you for your attention.
That we can discuss further on with teachers to create that
that course, that e-learning course. Let me just show you some of the questions of the questionnaire. Are you able to see from the top? Maybe not that much. Sorry, I'm just noticing that now. Just for you to know what I am trying to ask to this to these experts in terms of a framework. There's a framework underlying it. So, of course, when we are asked to forecast the future of using AI in education, in terms of academic, emotional data mapping for employability, so we can have systems that when we are 10, 11 years old, can tell us what we can do at the future because we are showing this type of skills. So we can be chosen to go to some type of university based on those systems that choose that sometimes for ourselves. Of course, online learning impact and also in terms of return on investment. The applications of AI in formal education, so automated assessment or feedback, the curated content, so the idea of having personalized content for me, the virtual teaching assistants too, and regarding the learner, the educator, and the school institution, trying to understand who will be the people that who we should be more worried about, and what kind of ingredients should be put in the system to care for the learner, the educator, and also the institution, the parents, when we introduce AI. Also, in terms of accountability, who is accountable for these results? What are the biases, the diversity, representation, and explainability? And in terms of accountability for AI function, in terms of cybersecurity, decision-making processes, and so on. Maybe I just have 3 minutes. I will not go on, but the idea that I didn't present in here, but just talk about the state of art. I wanted you to know what are the issues, the items that are being regarded in this part of the study. So, in the second part, we will create this dilemma. And then, with a focus group of 10 teachers, they will discuss these three dilemmas and the potential consequences to students' development of using that kind of technologies in the learning environments. Then, with that content, so they are all participatory processes, so the teachers will help me to generate this content for the learning course. So, what are the technologies we are talking about? The context frame, the people that are around AI that must be engaged in these processes, and create this framework for the learning course. So, all the content, the program length, and the strategies. So, the idea is that with this kind of methodology, we will reach better teachers' current attitudes towards AI. And so this kind of course will be more meaningful to them. So then they will do, I will have a group of teachers that will do this online course. And by the end, we will study the effects of this course on AI ethical challenges upon learning signification. Let us see if teachers talk more of the coherence of their narrative in terms of structure and content about AI ethical challenges. If they are able to, with this content, create lesson plans that intentionally integrate this kind of challenges, then rotate these sequences, so go into their classrooms and do this with their students, and then being capable of some self-assessment of their practices. Finally, so the idea is to understand this change in terms of their attitude and capability of talking about AI and using that on their lesson plans and classrooms, and then also to understand students' outputs to those activities and study those outputs, and also understand if these primary students are more aware and if their sense of agency and control was not affected, and if they are autonomous
understanding, their experience of learning, their interests, their values, their capabilities, although they are using AI, of course, for the much potential of the learning equation. So after this role taking, I will interview 5 teachers and understand their attitudes towards AI, the e-learning characteristics that might have contributed to those results, the teacher's perception of their capability and will to continue dealing with AI, and the main criteria teachers consider relevant for continuing professional development on AI AD. So with this, the idea is to create this framework and this online course. And thank you.
Some topics for the presentation: introduction, background certification, research objective, research question, methodology, and conclusion. In introduction, the rise of the information and communication technology and advances of cyberspace have revolutionized social interaction in all areas. And for that, education process have been transformed to respond to the new demand of the new era. During the last 20 years, virtual training or e-learning has become the new paradigm of high education around the world. In that sense, this research looks for knowing the situation of the virtual modality in higher education in Dominican Republic, as well as the challenges and needs. It now proposed experimental hypotheses. For this direction, some research questions are the objective and the research question are focused on 5 main actors. Number 1, the opinion of the institutional manager, the author of program in virtual modality in the university, the teaching of other professionals with training, the expectation, demand, and need for the student population, the theoretical methodological foundation used for the modality. Some background and justification. This area is known as the information and communication age, also known as the learning and knowledge society. During the last 2 decades, virtual education has become the new paradigm of higher education in the world. Latin America need a state foundation, some also take of that. Latin America needs a state foundation for very greater coverage and investment in research projects, also public policies that favor virtual education. In the Dominican Republic, the inclusion of the university in virtual education is at an early stage. E-learning practice need a clear theoretical and methodology basis. New way of conceiving education process and greater teacher training. Research objective the main objective is to identify the current state of higher education in the virtual modality in the Dominican Republic, as well as the need and challenges it presents in order to adapt to the knowledge society. Secondary, specific objective, to identify the programs that are offered in Dominican higher education institutions in the virtual modality, to verify the level of training in virtual education of the learning that the professor of the Dominican University have, to know the theoretical methodological foundations that prevails for e-learning practice in Dominican higher education. Some research questions, with respect to the offer of programs in virtual modality at the university, which Dominican University offer virtual education program? What type of program do they offer in relation to teachers of other type of personnel? What skills should a teacher have for the virtual modality, education modality? How many of the teachers who teach the virtual world are trained in virtual education? What are the main challenges, tackle problems faced by teachers in virtual programs? For the expectations, demands, and needs to the population, what are the current educational needs of upper level students? In which situation does a student prefer a virtual program to a face-to-face one? What should virtual programs look like from the student expectation? Based on the theoretical methodological foundation, is there a theoretical methodological foundation defined and coherent in university for virtual education program? How is the teaching process conceived? What is the methodology used? And how is learning conceived? There are more questions, but some questions. Methodology, this investigation plans propose a mixed research methodology and combines quantitative and qualitative methods. The research is interested to be descriptive and exploratory. There are no hypotheses for research questions that will be answered following an appropriate methodology. The target population are Dominican University and higher education institution. Finally, as well as conclusion, the research intended to respond to all the needs of the virtual modality in Dominican higher education. It does intend to surface the challenges and the need of the modality to respond to the demand of the student. Give suggestions to the institution involved about the possible improvements that could be implemented, and create a space for reflection and analysis to contribute to improving the situation of the virtual world. So, thank you for that.
Jose, I am in the program computer engineer of the University of Salamanca. The role of the fundamental concept of mathematics in teach and learning the basic concept of programming. My name Hossein and Director Francisco and Angel. That is the first affected competing apply to education the main objective problem is set the contribute and impact we intend to achieve conclusion and impact on the academic and research community. Main objective have the classification of the feelings generated during the teaching and learning of the programming that allows the, to contribute to the development of the specific didactic of the program in pre-university education. That research in Colombia with a student 14 and 15 year old. First, develop an application for get the feeling that generate during a process of teaching and learning and application what is in APP Inventor impact mapping, my investigation. Problems, the integer division algorithm, Fibonacci succession, the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. How can we collect the student opinions? Here the application of the Fibonacci succession. Observe the situation. The integer algorithm. First question. That dividend. Divisor contain a residue. Here, please.
Free.
Free?
Yes.
Okay. Applause, applause, applause. Yes. Here.
Four.
Four. Applause. Now, here, in the set integers, here,
this the application? Are there a problem?
Yeah, please. Only a even a person, only a correct answers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, José Alfredo. In the last presentation before the discussion, is the longitudinal design and evaluation of a child education intervention program based on the studies and things related to technology for the development of oral expression.
To 6 years in early childhood education throughout the stories and tales with technological support. and we'll have another 30 games related to our research. The approach and methods that we are going to use, the methodology of reference and resources, we are going to use an empirical and analytical methodology that is going to be quasi-experimental and quantitative to the lack of randomization of our groups because the units are already established in the schools. The basic result that we are going to use is the volume of Campbell and Steyr in the 60s on experimental and quasi-experimental designs in education and technology. And we have to say that we're going to use several collections of different stories and tests selected by different criteria. Just as we recovered that, the study number one for the design and evaluation of effectiveness in the pilot study in year one, the hypothesis is that the experimental project that we are going to use will have positive effects on the study development in the first years of the application. The design will be quasi-experimental with pre- and post-test measures, and with a control group. We are going to use permits and a confidentiality agreement must be signed because of the ethical reasons. There are different variables too, dependent variables such as the different levels of oral language in the students, independent variables such as the experimental project itself, the gender, family interaction, and other personal and contextual characteristics of interest. And we have some control variables too, such as gender too, family interaction, intellectual capacity, and others. The instruments and evidence of information collection that we are going to use are specific individual tests to evaluate the level of oral language in students. We're going to use socio-demographic and personal data of the students and a semi-structured family interview to assess the interaction in the environment. And the population sample will be 25 children in two units in two different schools. The study number two, application of the definitive program and evaluation of efficacy in the longitudinal study in year two. We have to say that the hypothesis designs, variables, instruments, and population sample will be the same as in year one, taking into account the possible changes that might occur from year one to year two, and taking into account too that we are now in a longitudinal study with two applications that have to be considered, and using a metric approach too. To conclude, the dissertation status in applying analysis to 3 years. We are now in phase one, elaboration of the theoretical framework, and in phase two, application of the pilot study, in which several points have been, such as the research plan has been already designed or reviewed, and others are in the design phase. And I must add that we expect different contributions in congresses in 2019 and different publications on several journals. That's all for now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Raquel. And the last presentation that was previously in another track. So the real last presentation is the evaluative model of practice-based teacher education for practices to enhance metacognition and lifelong learning by Kiyomi Matsumoto.
model in two phases. In the first phase, quantitative data will be collected with Likert scale to present this picture, Likert scale to teacher educators, and observation protocol. And qualitative data will be collected with in-depth interviews with present teachers and in-depth interviews with teacher educators. Then we will work in an evaluative model prototype. And in the second phase, quantitative data will be collected with semantic differential scale with teacher educators, teacher education experts, and stakeholders. And qualitative data in depth interview with teacher educators, teacher education experts, and stakeholders. Expected contributions. We hope to contribute to scientific community and teacher communities with evidence of the following. The field of initial teacher education in Ibero-American context, the teaching and evaluation of core practices, and the development of metacognitive process and lifelong learning among teacher education. We will develop an evaluative model of the learning of core practices which considers the development of metacognitive processes and lifelong learning orientations. Thank you.
Questions to the different participants? Any questions? No? Okay, don't worry. I have some questions and I'm pretty sure that Marisol also. Que salgan, pero están todos sentados acá.
Inside of them, there is this way of spreading hate speech. It's a bit more, it's not new, as I was saying, it's something that has already been done in the past. But because of the ecology of social media and digital media in general, I believe fake news is quite a problematic in general, but also it's a very relevant way of spreading. Something that has been proved in several studies. But it hasn't been so strongly analyzed. So the correct lack of knowledge there, and it was going to be interesting because it tackles two of the most relevant problematics together. So
other of you want to answer this question? Why do you focus on this topic? Maybe Laura can say something. Why focus on smoking?
Well, because it's a big problem in our country and in other countries in the world in general. So I think that the statistics now, like one level, have no efficacy for stopping smoking for the smokers. So we pretend create other intervention that will be more efficacy, like application, for example, in this case.
for me, one question too for Maximiliano, to Mexico. For Mexico.
Yes.
this is your contribution with this study. It's very interesting.
Yeah, well, actually, I want to try, well, in Mexico, it's not new, the ratio, but it's, I think, it's quite like the silent neighborhood. It's,
yes, it's
something
exactly.
You have, but you don't know. So I think in the next years it's gonna be a really big problem in Mexico. So I want to prevent, I don't know, next some aggressions or what situations, bad situations in this case. And if it would be social media, because when I saw the, I was here when I saw the Caravana Migrante, and I saw even my friends and family talking, why are they here? I don't know, to their homes. So I think, actually, I'm in Spain, I'm migrant, I know, it's complicated. So I try to help them this.
Some of you press different methodologies, but pretty similar.
Yes, very similar. And of course, studies about the recent methods. And yes, I'm done here. And no? No?
Alicia, I have a question.
You have a question? Perfect.
Yes, for Kiyomi. I think it's very interesting your topic. So what do you think that is the biggest challenge in the teacher training in your country or in your university?
Currently in my country, only two faculties work in practice-based teacher education. It's necessary to change because in my country it's very traditional, the training of teachers is only focused in disciplinary and methodologic knowledge, and the practical steps assume it will be learning in the field experience. And in the campus or into the course, nothing of practical steps. And practice based ensure work in this practical in this area. Chile is very grown. It's difficult. Change the faculties of education is very additional, and it's necessary a change because the children need a good teachers from the first day. No 1 year after 1 year or 2 years. The first day, the children need a good teachers, and it's necessary the change.
Thank you.
what's your intention with this, framework, with this tool to be used? Used by the student, by the teachers? What's the role? Catch very well what is the role of this tool in the mathematical learning.
Mi interés es poder contribuir al desarrollo de una didáctica específica de la programación de educación preuniversitaria, básicamente con estudiantes de octavo, noveno grado en el sistema educativo colombiano, 14, 15 años. Una manera de aproximarme a ese propósito es atraer a los chicos y a las chicas, sobre todo a las chicas, hacia el aprendizaje de la programación. He ensayado con Scratch, pero también he ensayado con App de Invento y me resulta mucho más atractivo App de Invento, entre otras porque además de los bloques tienen que tener una lógica de programación. En Brasil he visto un software desarrollado en Brasil que permite evaluar los proyectos hechos en la propia Invento, así como el que hizo la B. Juan Carlos para evaluar los proyectos de Scratch de memoria. Entonces, por eso me gusta muchísimo la propia Invento. Otra razón por la que me gusta la propia Invento es porque durante 3 meses estuve haciendo el año pasado unas prácticas con estudiantes de grado noveno y ellos hacían las aplicaciones y era muy agradable que las podían probar inmediatamente en el móvil. Y en ese momento el interés era que pudieran desarrollar aplicaciones que les permitieran aprender otras áreas, fundamentalmente el área de matemáticas. Y uno de los problemas detectados es que quizás los algoritmos iniciales con los que se empieza son los algoritmos que tienen que ver con matemáticas. Y noté que había deficiencias incluso entre los profesores sobre conceptos fundamentales de la matemática. Por ejemplo, el algoritmo de la división en los números enteros dio muchísimos problemas incluso con profesores, porque cuando le da 2 números positivos, muy fácil, ¿verdad? Pero cuando al menos uno es negativo, falla. Y programas como C...
Pero 1 es 100, el otro es muy easy calculate.
Por ejemplo, si tú tienes menos 25 dividido entre 2.
Sí, pero la diferencia de operación es más difícil de hacer división por 8. ¿Sí? Es más fácil to calculate 25 division by 5 or 7. Yes. Do que 100 a division by 8. There's a great difference between the calculations.
Sin embargo, da igual si haces menos 100 entre 8 a si haces menos 25 entre 2. Creo que la dificultad está en que no estamos bien familiarizados con la definición matemática del algoritmo de la división de los enteros. Incluso estuve probando ese algoritmo en las primitivas que vienen en lenguajes como C++ y Java, y tenemos 2 primitivas, la del resto y la de la división entera. Y esos 2 programas, C++ y Java, fallan en eso, porque si le metes menos 100 y 8, te da el resultado equivocado. No te da menos 13, que debería darnos. Entonces, observo cómo hay dificultades en la apropiación de los conceptos fundamentales de la matemática. ¿Sí? Otra de las situaciones que hemos abordado era resolver un sistema de ecuaciones 2x2 cuando las variables eran denominadores. Y allí surgió un problema importante, que era el concepto de escala. Para poder representar en el método gráfico la solución a ese sistema de ecuaciones. Y vimos que una de las dificultades era justamente la apropiación de cómo calcular el mínimo común múltiplo y el máximo común divisor.
Por eso fue necesario desarrollar una aplicación que nos permitiera encontrar eso. Pero más que desarrollar la aplicación, es un pretexto para poder enseñarle, no solo a los estudiantes, sino a los profesores, conceptos básicos de programación, conceptos de ciclos, variables, condicionales, etc., usando conceptos fundamentales de la matemática.
Tengo que chequear, pero
las divisiones
en Java se
hacen. Dale, Rodri, un poquito más allá del tema de los conceptos básicos de bucles, interacciones y demás, está el tema de la semántica relacionada con el lenguaje, de los tipos, del tipado y de los tipos de operaciones. Entonces, un ejemplo típico, el igual, para un matemático es una misma cosa. Para un informático, si te cuatro vas a
puede ser la división, puede ser.
Con la división entera, con la división real, con la división
que es.
Pasa lo mismo, o sea, depende qué operación está llamando y cuando el lenguaje te facilita esa operación con un símbolo, ese símbolo qué significa.
Los invito a todos que esta tarde, antes de acostarse, vayan a lenguaje C++, a lenguaje Java y ensayen. Por ejemplo, -118, a ver si es cierto que era el resultado que esperamos que desde la matemática.
Claro, porque ese símbolo de dividir no es exactamente el correcto el que estás usando.
Exactamente.
Usar una operación para la cual el lenguaje no existe símbolo. Hay que definirla con una operación aparte, con la división. Hay lenguaje que facilita con cierto como símbolo, hay lenguaje que dice, bueno, es normal, que se puede hacer con sobrecarga, y otro, pues, simplemente inventar una división como el. Movimientos enteros y el DIC. Tienes que usar la base, la base no es división entera, es el DIC. Y bueno, depende del. Habría muchísimas cosas de los lenguajes de programación que están un poco ajenos nada más. Se fundamentan en las matemáticas, pero van un poquito más allá, un pasito. Allá de las matemáticas y que hay que interpretar también con la perspectiva de toda la semántica de los lenguajes de programación. Hay que haber muchísimas cosas.
Muchísimas gracias.
So we are on time to go to the coffee break. Think about your presentation because this afternoon you will have time to work together. And after the coffee break, and help us later to continue the session. Okay, thank you very much.
Ya, con una cara siguiente, la cara feliz de presentaron. Así, con una sonrisota ya la satisfacción. Gracias.